It's not good. It's not good. It's been startling. Mm-hmm. The injuries have been severe, and I'm hoping that this will help to get the word out. We're seeing cases where patients have been vaping for months prior to presenting to their doctor. They're having symptoms that look like typical infectious symptoms, cough, fever, shortness of breath, that sort of thing. The patients have stopped vaping, gone home with sort of typical treatment for pneumonia or bronchitis, and continued to get worse, and then presented back to the hospital to figure out why they are becoming sicker.
How many cases are we talking about?
Four so far.
Four here, mm-hmm. that you've personally treated?
Yes.
And ages?
16 to 18, teenagers.
I'm guessing that these 16 to 18 year olds have been doing this for a while?
Some for months, some for years.
How are those kids doing?
I really can't comment about the specifics of each case other than to say that we've seen really serious injury and illness.
And you're not talking about just a cough or something that's not
no.
going away?
No. So the patients that we've seen this summer at Children's Minnesota have been critically ill. They've required help with their breathing, they've required oxygen, they've required machines to help them breathe in some instances, really ill.
What have you been able to find out from these patients on what might be contributing to it? Do you think it's something with the devices themselves, what they're smoking? Yeah. I know in Wisconsin they're talking about everything from nicotine to THC.
Yeah, it's really difficult to know. It's very common for patients to use nicotine-based products and THC products, and they may use one at certain social instances and others in another. The cases in Minnesota have reported using both.
So is this something that you believe might be more prevalent even than you're seeing?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes.
Do you have other suspected cases that you're working on?
Yes.
How many?
I can't give specifics to it yet. Part of that is that we're looking at the infectious causes first.
So you have to go through test after test after
right.
test to rule everything else out
right.
before you diagnose this.
It's been a very extensive process so far.
Have you spoken to any others in your field
yes.
that have shared concerns with you as well?
Yes, we've reached out to experts in Milwaukee. We've spoken with world-renowned pathologists looking at lung biopsies. So we are, and we're reviewing the literature on vaping and inhalational injury and chemical injury, what's been published thus far.
Is there reason to believe that this isn't gonna go away?
So there's a real worry for long-term damage. Right now we're seeing severe injury, and we know that anyone who has a severe lung injury can have lasting damage. My other really big worry is, as a medical community, we've had decades to study the effects of smoking cigarettes or smoking marijuana in the traditional routes. And we know some of the short-term risks, and we know a lot about the long-term risks. With vaping, we're seeing really early severe injury with early use, and that makes me concerned for the long term.
Is there a worry that kids are afraid to report that
Absolutely.
They're vaping?
Yeah. Typically, we find that teenagers don't really want to talk about risky behaviors with their parents present.
What would you tell parents?
Parents need to know that we're hearing from these teenagers that they thought it was safe. And a lot of the marketing around vaping products speaks to having very few ingredients or having food-grade products. And just because something is safe in your stomach doesn't mean it's safe in your lungs. I don't think there's a safe dose. And I don't think I can tell these families that there's a safe amount right now. And that's very worrisome.